Hey everyone, DM Xavier here. If you're enjoying the content on this channel, please click the like button below, subscribe, share, and don't forget to click the bell icon to ensure you get notifications as soon as I upload new content. Without further ado, let's begin. Episode 4, Part 4, The Sunken Ruins. The group awoke from their exceptionally restless rests and prepared themselves for the task ahead. They took time to prepare appropriate spells through prayer and ritual, and sharpen their blades and fill their bellies with what rations they had with them. Once they had finished their preparations, Meepo took the lead and brought the group back down the southern hall and to the door on the western wall that he'd told them about the night prior.
Okay, this is where Goblin territory begins. They take no prisoners, usually, unless they're gonna use them as a ransom. We're looking for a tiny white dragon baby. He's got a bad attitude, but he's gonna be a good help if I can talk to him.
Meepo told the group. They collectively nodded, and Droven took the point at the door. Droven slowly opened the door. The familiar glow of Heskin's mace lit the darkened chamber, showing nothing inside besides lonely piles of rat droppings, crumbled flagstone, and a few nameless stains. Empty, Droven said. It's like goblins to give themselves a barrier like this before they start utilizing defensive maneuvers. Be alert. Their race is hyper-aggressive to outsiders. With that, he approached a wooden door on the northern wall and put his ear to it. It's quiet, but that doesn't mean it's empty, he said to the rest of the group. Droven reached down, depressed the handle on the door, and swung it open. As he did, a cacophony of metallic objects tied to strings on the opposite side crashed against each other loudly, rousing a shout from the opposite end of the 10-foot-wide hallway, which was liberally strewn with sharp caltrops. The northern door of the hall was missing, but the room beyond was partially blocked off by a roughly mortared 3-foot-high wall, complete with crenellations. Two green-skinned heads with jagged teeth and elongated floppy ears peeked over the edge of the wall. Droven shouted to the rest of the group, "The hallway's caked with caltrops! Anyone have a quick way to move them?" As he finished, a crude 3-foot-long javelin slammed into the wall next to him, shattering on impact. He looked up just in time to see the second javelin flying true. He gasped and braced himself, taking the full brunt of the goblin projectile in the abdomen. He cried out as Briseis pushed past him. She breathed deeply, focusing her internal energy into a chest full of bardic magic. With that, she flashed an arcane sign with her right hand and thrust forward, yodeling a string of enchantment that burst forth as a thunderous wave, sending the caltrops in the hallway full force at the goblin barricades. The goblin on the right ducked in time to avoid the barrage, but the goblin on the left took no less than 7 iron caltrops to the head and neck, sending it tumbling backward. Seeing its fellow goblin brutally fall, the remaining sentry turned and began to sprint away from the group. By this time, Heskin had removed the javelin from Droven and unleashed a spring of healing energy into him, closing the wound.
"Damned goblins! They're clever little shits," Droven said while he looked up at the noise-making device that had been set on the door.
The group gathered a few bags worth of caltrops before heading into the room that the goblins had hidden in. The room was clearly much used over the years by creatures who had very little care for hygiene, as the floor was covered in a layer of filth, shabby hides, and some very unmentionable stains that littered the walls. The room itself was home to barrels of partially rotten and well-worn javelins, as well as buckets of fetid meat and stale water. The goblin that Briseis had killed lay on the floor just over the crude wall, its blood still pooling underneath it. "The one that got away went to get help. I'd bet 50 gold on it," Heskin said to the group as they searched the room. Fenton glanced over and said, "You're right. Either to come back or to set an ambush. We need to move quickly to get the jump on them. Everyone understand?" Everyone nodded, including Meepo, who now gripped his spear with both hands, keeping his shield slung across his back. Droven took the point again as they turned the corner and began to walk south down a 10-foot-long hallway to another wooden door that stood closed. Droven listened intently at the door.
Gramsik Nika Obobo Heshkahaka Titi Niha Bruchim Ka Okishim Ni kukutiha ni morsu kavasviv. Kwelishim nini hishi kashi tunchi nakoti wahaka.
I can hear a handful of them on the other side, Droven said. I don't know what they're saying, but they sound excitable. With that, Droven thrust the door open, revealing another 20-foot-long hallway that opened to the west. As he did so, Meepo pushed past him with a wild screech and a battle cry.
Aye, for Israel! The Keeper of the Dragons has come for the goblin blood!
The group watched in complete shock and horror as Meepo ran around the corner, the rest of the group in hot pursuit. As he entered the open room, dozens of blunted and broken javelins lay on the cracked cobblestone floor, though a few actually protruded from three crudely sewn, human-sized targets that hung along the center of the southern wall. The northern third of the room was separated from the south by a crudely mortared and crenulated half wall. A permanent camp of sorts lay past the wall and along the northern half of the room. Meepo entered the target range and stopped dead in his tracks. Ahead of him stood five goblins atop the wall, all of which had a javelin either reared back or already in the air. Time seemed to slow for just a moment as the group watched the first javelin catch the poor kobold square in the chest, lifting him off the ground and carrying him back 3 feet before impaling him upright to the floor. A second javelin hit just above the first, cementing him in place. Meepo gasped and looked at the group, his hands and head shaking violently.
For Yuzdrael!
He coughed as blood began to pour from his wounds and mouth. He reared back with the last bit of strength that he had and launched his own spear, sending it sailing through the air and catching one of the goblins on the wall in the chest, throwing it back off of the barricade and out of sight. With that, Meepo faded from existence as two more javelins landed true, turning his now corpse into a pincushion of reptilian flesh. Brises entered the room next, tears streaming from her face and onto her tunic. She slid hard on the ground behind Meepo's corpse. She drew back on her short bow, and using his body as cover, fired over his head, clipping one of the goblins in the shoulder. Another javelin clattered off the floor next to her. Gash entered next, screaming as she frothed from the mouth. She hit the ground in front of the goblins with her axe, using it as leverage to vault herself up and over the wall. When she landed, she began to swing wildly at the assailants on the wall. Droven, Fenton, and Heskin all began to move, each drawing their melee weapons and charging the wall. Brises continued to fire over Meepo, who took another two javelins before the combat had concluded. The final standing goblin attempted to flee through a door to the north, though was luckily stopped by a well-timed bolt of divine energy loosed by Heskin, turning the small goblinoid into a smoldering pile of flesh. The group gathered in the southern chamber of the room, which housed a single, closed, wooden door on the western wall. Brises continued to weep as she removed the javelins from Meepo's body.
He was a legitimate friend. Not to say that you all aren't, but he barely knew us, and he willingly threw himself into harm's way. He saved me back in those cells and again here. I'll never forget you, Meepo, she said through sniffles.
Heskin and Droven both said a prayer over the fallen kobold before laying his body near the door of the room they'd just entered. Fenton then motioned to the door on the western wall.
I swear I just heard someone speaking the common tongue from behind here just a moment ago, he said.
The group approached the door and readied themselves. Droven took point again and pushed it open. Squalor obviously reigned in this long, low dungeon. Three small, horned humanoids sat roughly tied with crude ropes to a large spike near the entrance. Farther back, a battered gnomish man, roughly 4 feet tall, with light brown hair, bright blue eyes, and a short and very well-trimmed goatee, languished inside a rusted iron cage, which was small even for his tiny frame. Several sets of corroded manacles were connected to the walls, which remained empty except for the occasional crumbling skeleton.
What the hell is this? Droven said. Is this a prison?
Quickly, Gash, free the kobolds. Brises, can you try and open the lock on the gnome's cage? Briseis rushed to the rear of the chamber while Gash went to work breaking the ropes that bound the kobolds. She crouched down next to the cage and peered inside. The man was obviously emaciated from neglect.
"Excuse me, sir. I'm going to get you out of here, all right? Please hold on and we'll get you some food," she said.
The man smiled and looked up as she began to pick the lock.
"Looks like it's my lucky day,"
he chuckled.
"Garl Glittergold be praised."
Briseis finished picking the lock with an audible click. The lock popped open and she quickly removed it and opened the door, allowing the man to stand for the first time in ages.
"Well, I'll be damned. A whole rescue party, huh?"
the gnome said with an odd sense of enthusiasm while looking the group over.
"My name's Urquhart Timbers, luckiest gnome on Trubenshard. Even if I did just spend a year in goblin captivity,"
he chuckled. The group sat the captives down and provided them with some of their rations. Fenton then focused his mind and brought a spell to life with a few druidic words and a sigil of water, which he traced in the air. The spell concluded, and water began to pour from his hands, allowing all four of the captives to drink their share before the spell ended. The group spoke with Urquhart for almost 30 minutes and learned that he'd been captured a year ago by the goblins near the ravine while hunting for a family heirloom around Bree. Since he'd been down here, he'd learned that the goblins take orders from an evil druid in the grove below the temple. The druid creates a fruit during the summer called the Midsummer Fruit and gives it to the goblins to sell for supplies and food. And in the winter, he creates a fruit from a tainted tree in his grove called the Midwinter Fruit, which is also sold, but on the underground market. The Midwinter Fruit is said to contain an extremely potent toxin. The group asked about the other adventurers, and he had indeed seen them about 2 weeks ago. For about 2 weeks, where they were held captive alongside him before they were brought down to the grove level per the druid's request. Unfortunately, he hadn't seen them since. The group finished feeding the prisoners and provided Urquhart with some armor and weapons from the slain goblins before sending him with the kobold captives and the body of Meepo back the way they'd come to find refuge among the kobold tribe. The group then moved north through the room where Meepo had met his end and approached a wooden door that sat closed along the northern wall. Droven listened at the door before determining that it was clear. With a quick shove, he popped the door open and glanced around the hallway, which was no more than 7 feet wide and 35 feet long, running east to west. A single wooden door sat along the northern wall, across from where they currently stood, and a second wooden door along the western wall, both of which were currently closed. An awkwardly placed brown and red shaggy rug lay on the floor in front of the western door. The group entered and approached the rug. Heskin bent down and lifted the rug from in front of the door, revealing a very poorly hidden pit trap that descended about 10 feet into the ground. At the bottom, rusted caltrops lay scattered about. "Well, I've seen some bad traps before, but this definitely takes the cake. I wonder if anybody's actually fallen victim to this," he said while he tossed the rug aside. Briseis peered over the edge of the pit.
"Poorly hidden, yes, but brutal nonetheless."
Briseis then put her ear to the western door before pulling it back quickly, touching her ear.
"Whoa, the door's freezing cold. Like, unnaturally cold,"
she said as she rubbed her ear, trying to bring warmth back to it. Fenton approached the door and touched it gently. After a moment of pondering, he turned around. "The dragon is in this room. This frost is naturally produced through a creature, and since we know that there's a white dragonling somewhere down here, I'd bet he's inside," he said. Droven approached the door, sidestepping the pit. "I'm sure you're right. We need to make sure that we knock it out. Don't kill it. I'm guessing it won't come peacefully as we don't have Meepo here with us, so we need to be careful." The group nodded in agreement before Droven took point and pushed the door open. Mounted and stuffed animal heads adorned the walls. The mounting job was sloppy, and the assortment of heads included cattle, rats, and other not particularly impressive specimens. However, a few grisly trophies shared the walls with the animals, including a couple of kobolds. Smashed and broken cabinets and small tables littered the periphery of the room, mute victims to some sort of rampage. A rusted iron spike stood askew in the center of the room, trailing a broken chain. Thin patches of ice coated sections of the walls, floors, and debris. As the door swung open, an audible hiss followed by a loud screech resonated through the chamber. From underneath a circular wooden table, a burst of ice and freezing mist erupted, catching Droven, Fenton, and Gash full force, freezing part of their legs and abdomen quickly before skin split. "It's under the table," Droven shouted to the group while pointing out the now visible dragonling, which was only about 4 feet long and 3 feet tall, with tiny, ice-blue pinprick eyes and glistening white baby scales. Heskin sidestepped the three caught in the breath attack and swung down at the dragonling, striking it in the back of the head with the butt of his mace. It reeled back under the strike but didn't falter. Briseis entered behind Heskin and closed the door behind her, before turning and whispering an incantation that manifested as a dark, draconic insult. Pink psychic energy built around the little creature's head before collapsing inwards, causing a trickle of blood to drip from its nose. Droven broke free at the same time as Gash, and the two rushed forward, pummeling the dragonling in unison. Calicrix backed itself into the northwest corner and breathed deeply again, letting out another burst of ice and freezing mist at its attackers. Droven caught a large shard of ice in his chest and fell backwards, shivering and bleeding profusely in his unconscious state. Fenton rushed to his side, focusing his druidic magic on healing and sending vines of green energy throughout his body, causing the wounds to quickly mend shut. Gash removed a length of rope from her backpack and attempted to grab and bind the dragonling. When she did, it bit and clawed her body, rending her flesh with its dagger-like teeth. Heskin continued to strike with his mace until finally, after what felt like an eternity, he managed to land a lucky blow that knocked the little dragon into unconsciousness. Gash quickly tied it with her rope, and Heskin applied a simple cantrip, sparing it from death. Heskin turned to the group and focused inward. He invoked a divine incantation and held his shield out as hundreds of motes of golden divine energy burst from him, clinging to his allies' wounds, sealing them shut in the process. "I think we need to get this dragon back to Yuzdryl before we go any further. We haven't made it to the grove yet, and I think that having it with us will slow us down," Droven said to the group. Briseis nodded. "I'm inclined to agree. Let's backtrack and rest for a little while before we come back this way." The group collected what they could carry from the room, save for the gnarly trophies that the goblins had kept, and made their way back the way they'd come before they reached kobold territory again. When they arrived, a sentry escorted the group back to Yuzdryl's throne room. The group laid out the now unconscious and hog-tied dragonling. Yuzdryl yipped and shouted to her guards, who rushed to the creature, untying it and carrying it to another room to the north.
"You some my saviors. You bring back my baby, and now I am in your debt. You and your friends are welcome to stay here for as long as you like,"
she shouted.
"I heard about Meepo. It's a shame. But he will be remembered as my dragon keeper for eternity. That I can promise you. And your gnomish friend, the little guy. He come back here and then he say he need to leave again. So we show him to the surface. We give him some food, too."
"You're welcome, Yuzdryl. We intend on ridding the remainder of this home of yours of the goblins. However, as payment for finding your dragon, I'd like to request that you open trade lines with the people of Bree. You have many things down here that they may like, and they're used to open trade with the goblins. Just think about it. But that's what I'd like as repayment," Droven said. The rest of the group looked at Droven, unaware that this was his intention as repayment. Yuzdryl nodded.
"Yes. If this is what you want, then I will speak to the mayor once you have rid the entirety of our home. If you need to rest, you can go back there and rest. We will give you a food and some drink,"
she said, pointing to the far eastern wall of the chamber. The group nodded, thanked her, and turned to the eastern wall, where a single wooden door stood closed. They approached and opened it, revealing several small but smoky bonfires that lit the wide and high chamber. Spits, tanning racks, and other implements of a primitive culture were clearly visible throughout the haze. Several small figures busily worked and played within the chamber. Most of them stopped and stared in awe as the group entered. A sentry at the door barked and yipped briefly before the tense gawking stopped. The group then took to the far southeastern corner of the chamber, which was the only spot that stood open for seating, laid out their bedrolls, made themselves as comfortable as they could before lying down for a rest to ensure that they had enough strength to venture into the grove below. Thank you again to all of my viewers and subscribers. I can't wait to read your comments and hear your feedback on this episode. Please remember to like this video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, share the video, and of course comment below with your favorite moment from the episode. Stay tuned for episode 4, part 5, The Sunken Ruins, as it will premiere later this week. Until next time, my friends, be well and roll 20s.